Heavenly Father, we thank you that that we have the people here to listen to your word. I earnestly pray that it is through your Spirit that you have sent and compelled the people to be here, that there may be that special message that we carry with us for the years of our lives, that it may lead to a closer walk with Jesus. Lord, we pray for those who are not here, they may be discouraged, unable, or just perhaps not able to make it for any reason whatsoever, but we pray that you bring each and every one back to the fold of this congregation. We thank you for the privilege that we can be in this city, that we can be a fountain of living water to those around us, and as we try to reach out, Lord, give us the wisdom and the tact to reach other people for Jesus. So Lord, we pray for the world that we live in. Lord, we look at our politicians and we look at the up-and-coming election and one wonders what motivates, but Lord, help us to pray for these people that you allow to be in charge. That somehow through your Spirit, their minds may be guided. We pray for the world at large. We think of the refugee problem. Lord, the official day will be the 20th of June, but the problem is so intense. We're looking at a world that is increased in violence. We're looking at a world where indifference reaches new heights. We look at a world where the brutality of humanity against humanity is breaking every boundary. It is time for Jesus to come. And so, Lord, we earnestly pray that this intense suffering will motivate us to do what we can do, but knowing that it must find place, help us to stand for the good, the right thing, and help us to help others to prepare themselves for that inevitable day that is coming so soon, when Jesus will return. And so, Lord, I commend the speaker to you and bless him, bless us through him, and that we may relieve, that we may leave this place enriched and empowered. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. We have a special item, and thank you so much, Izzy, for doing that. Thank you.
much your grace really means, the price that I could never pay was paid at Calvary. So instead of trying to repay you, I'm learning to simply obey you by giving up my life to you for all that you've given to me.
Preaching in many places, or you often go, and I come back sometimes to the same place, and I ask myself the question, did these people hear what I said last time? And then the Lord pulls my ear and says, did you hear what I said to you so many times? The lesson that we most quickly forget is that we cannot earn salvation. That we cannot earn brownie points towards God. But somehow every day, as we face temptation, as we face trials, as we face our daily life, we go back to that. So natural, that song is just so true. And you know what? Our Father is so kind, isn't he?
Yeah.
He's just so wonderful. So wonderful. I want to give you the good news now. How are we accepted before God? I've told you how we are not accepted. We are not accepted by our works. And some people come to me and say, oh, that's bad news. And they feel as if suddenly the whole world has collapsed. But you know what? It's the best news that can actually be told to us. Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. If you have come here with a sense of your unworthiness, with a complete acknowledgement of how sinful and wicked and unable you are of offering God anything, if you see that you're bankrupt spiritually and that you cannot earn God's favor, heaven says blessed. And the word blessed means seven times happy. So rather than say, if the previous sermon has shaken the comfort of your feet and you're feeling good because you're doing certain things, you're believing certain things, if now you've come to the realization that you have nothing, let me say to you, blessed is the best thing that can happen to you.
Amen.
warning because of what you've done. If you can look back at your life and you can only see a big mess, and you realize that you cannot fix it, you are blessed. There's no better point to come in life, to come to a point where all your dreams for greatness, where all your achievements have come crashing down, and you've come to a full realization that you cannot. When you're broken and you're weak and you're tender, when you face your failures, when the mask is removed and you're allowed to see how wicked you are, then heaven says, blessed. When you're longing and crying for something better, when you want your life to be transformed, heaven says, blessed. There's no better place for a human being to be than the place where we need a Savior. Amen?
Amen.
I'd like you to come with me to the book of Luke again. Now, why was the tax collector justified? Why was he accepted by God? Because he had nothing to offer. Amen?
Yeah.
And who did he come to find remedy for his problem? To God. That's it. I've said everything I'm going to say. If we want to be accepted by God, come to Him with your hands empty. And the Lord will fill them. Amen?
Amen?
Luke chapter 22. Oh, chapter 23, sorry. And we'll take it from verse 39. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. But the other answering rebuked him, saying, do you not even fear God, seeing you're under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly I say to you today, you shall be with me in paradise. How long did it take for this man to be accepted by God? You know, this man is crucified. He hangs there because he has lived a life of thievery. He is a thief. And in the eyes of all the human beings that are surrounding him, they look at him with scorn. They say to him, you deserve this thing, that you've been wicked, so on and on and on and on. But this man dies a saint. In the eyes of God, this thief is no longer a thief. And some people call it the good thief. There is no such thing as a good thief. This man ceased to be a thief and became a saint. Do you know how long it took?
Either way.
Just like that. He was accepted by God in the twinkling of an eye. And what everyone saw a thief, God saw a saint. If we want to be in heaven, we want to experience what the thief experienced. Amen?
Amen?
So what was the experience of the thief? Well, the thief was crucified with Christ, wasn't he? All hope of doing anything was lost because he could do nothing for himself. True? But he still couldn't, like the other thief, turn to himself and feel sorry for himself and scorn Jesus. The other thief thought that that he was still good. But this thief says, we deserve it. He has
has done nothing good. But he has done everything good, nothing evil. And then I am, every time I read that statement, I am amazed by the faith of this thief. While everyone around Jesus smoked him, treated him like he was a scam, they laughed at him, even his own apostles ran away from him, the thief looked at him and he saw in this dying man a king. And he said, remember me when you come in your kingdom. Dear friends, it is faith that takes hold of what God offers and makes it a reality to us. In that very moment, through the eyes of faith, this man saw in the dying Jesus a conquering king. What an amazing faith! Don't you reckon? What was the experience that created faith in the heart of this thief? It came all the way back to John the Baptist. But as he is looking to Jesus, as he is walking with Jesus behind him, and he hears the way he behaves, the way he speaks to the women, the way he prays for those who are crucifying him, as he looks at his face, as he contemplates this man, in the heart of the thief is born faith, the Holy Spirit implanted faith. The faith of Christ was given to him and it enabled him to see in Christ a conquering king.
Amen.
And the very moment that he expresses that faith, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom, heaven saves him. Boom, and that man dies a saint.
Praise the Lord.
What an amazing way that heaven has of doing things. Heaven does not expect you to offer anything. God longs for you to take from him everything. Did you hear that? Many of us spend our life trying to go give something to God, but God says, don't give me anything. Take from me everything. You and I must come to the point of being crucified, where we can have, give, do nothing. When we are bankrupt, unable, blind, mute, deaf, we can do nothing. Then, only then, when we by faith turn to our Savior, then the Savior can give us absolutely everything.
Amen. Amen.
Absolutely everything. So how are we accepted before God? Let me say this, and I'm going to say it slowly and clear. We are accepted because of Jesus.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Did you hear that?
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to cover one ear. Block my ear, come on. Everyone, block my ear, because the problem is I say it, it comes through this ear and it flies out of the ear. You're going to block it. We are accepted because of Jesus. Is that clear?
Amen.
I can't say it any clearer. I'm going to read you some texts that say this very clearly. Then we're going to come back and answer the question, what happened in the moment that this man believed in Christ? I want you to come to Jeremiah chapter 23. This is a beautiful verse. Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 5 and 6. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord. Jeremiah chapter 23, verses 5 and 6. Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will raise to David a branch of righteousness. A king shall reign and prosper and execute judgment and righteousness in the earth. Who is that branch of David? That branch of righteousness is Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Verse 6, in his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will dwell safely. Now this is his name by which He will be called. What is the name by which he is going to be called? It says not as the Lord. What does it say next? Our righteousness. The Lord, our righteousness. You see, we have no righteousness. We cannot offer any righteousness. We have none who is righteous. We are unrighteous. And so in order to be accepted by God, we need to have some righteousness. Else is bankrupt, nothing. And so God in Christ has given us all the righteousness we will ever need. Amen? Christ has become our righteousness. And he who has Christ has that righteousness. If you have no Christ, you have no righteousness. But if you have Christ, doesn't matter how rotten your life may have been, doesn't matter what you have faced, what you have done, if you take hold of Jesus like that thief took hold of Jesus, then you have the righteousness that is required for God to accept you. It's as simple as that.
Amen.
As a matter of fact, God has made Jesus. Come to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. God has made Jesus everything. Everything that we need. I preached that sermon this morning at church as part of the revival that we are running. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 29, 30 and 31. That no flesh should glory in his presence. And notice now, but of him you are in Christ Jesus. So when we are in Christ Jesus, we now belong to God the Father. We are his. But of him, you are in Christ Jesus. And notice what it says now. Who became for us. What did he become for us? What did he become on our behalf? What did he become so that he can give it to us? He became the wisdom of God. And what does it say next? Righteousness and sanctification and redemption. Did you notice what that text says? That our Jesus, our Savior, God has made him to be everything that we need for our salvation.
Amen.
Jesus is our righteousness. But not only our righteousness, Jesus is our sanctification. But not only our sanctification, he is also our redemption. The final events of human history are all guaranteed for you and I who love Jesus Christ. Our final resurrection if we die, our final transformation, our glorification, everything is guaranteed in Jesus. If you have Jesus, God has given you in Christ his own righteousness. He has given you his own holiness. And he has given you the power that eventually will even raise you from the dead. Everything is guaranteed in Christ. Christ is a massive package that God has given. And in that package, everything is included. Did you know that when Adam and Eve sinned, they forsook, they abandoned the right that God had given them, even to the use of air. And so you and I, because of our sin, do not deserve to drink water, to eat food, to breathe air. All that has been forsaken because we abandon our relationship with God and we sin against him. And the wages for sin is death. So in Christ, God has given us an amazing package. In Jesus, everything that the human race needs has been given as a gift that is contained in a person. The Bible says that Jesus is our life. The life that you have comes from Jesus. The Bible says that Jesus is our health. The health you have comes from Jesus. All healing only comes because of Jesus. The clothes you wear come because of Jesus. Jesus is our clothing. Jesus is our bread. The food you eat comes because of Jesus. God has made Jesus our perfection. In him, we are complete. Everything, friends, absolutely everything, to the minutest detail, has been given to us because of Jesus. I don't dance, but when I think of this, man, it makes me want to dance. I am bankrupt. I have nothing if God has left it for me to try to work my own salvation, to earn His favor. Dear friends, we would be hopelessly dark, lost. But God has given us a Savior. And in that Savior, everything you will ever need has already been given to you. And we only got amen. You know, the other day I was thinking of these things. I love to go to pray in a park. And I park my car, I read my Bible, pray, and then I go for about an hour's walk. And I was thinking about this. And I became excited. This is my favorite thing of the scriptures. There's no one around. It's a very lonely park. And I said, praise the Lord. So beautiful. Yeah. If you have Jesus, you have everything. If you do not have Jesus, you have nothing. Amen?
Amen.
So when that thief turned to Jesus and says, oh Lord, in that moment, before he even requested, the very fact that that thief said, oh Lord, right there and then, everything was given. In the eyes of God, he was justified, he was sanctified, and he was perfected. All at once. Why? Because he had Christ. It's beautiful. Are you empty? Bankrupt? I think I told you the story of Lily. Last time I came. Lily is a girl that came to me. He rang the pastor and said, I'm in trouble. And she came to see me. And we met. And she was broken. She said to me, Pastor, when I look at my past, I can see nothing good. My life is a mess. A mess. And she was crying, boiling her eyes out. And she told me all the experiences she had gone through and almost made me cry. A horrible life. Addicted. And then I looked at her. The Lord brought to my mind, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So I said, Lily, it may not feel like that, but this is the best place you can ever be. I said, how can that be? Because the Lord says, blessed are the poor in spirit, those who have nothing, those who are crying because of their bankrupt life, they are blessed in heaven. And Lily, you're at that point. You know what? We've been meeting for about six, eight weeks. And she came to church for the first time yesterday, last night. Her life, I am astounded how quickly she has changed. She hasn't changed, the Lord has changed. Give up the alcohol, give up the smokes. She now the Lord is convicting her of the relationship she's living in, and she's advanced. And you know, last Wednesday we met, and she said, Pastor Sam, I am afraid, and I am advancing too slow. I almost had a like I said, Lydia, I said, I have never seen someone moving so fast. Why? Because she came empty-handed to God. She knew she had nothing, and so she has clung to her Savior with everything she has. You know, when she comes and we start talking, during the week, the Lord has been revealing to her righteousness by faith. Just through the communion with the Holy Spirit, she has learned to love this Savior, to cling to Him. And she says, oh, Pastor Sam, the Lord has shown me that I have nothing to offer Him. And I said, praise the Lord, Lily. And so what did you do? He says, I take everything from Him. Oh, hallelujah. Man, she's learning. Some people, I have to knock them on the head to learn this lesson. She's learning so fast. So beautiful, amen? Yeah. Why? Because she knew that she was bankrupt. The greatest disease that sin has given us is to believe that we are good. Oh, I pray, Lord, please give me a sense of my wickedness, because I am a Pharisee since I am a little boy. I was born in the Adventist church. And because I grew up and I never left the church, I did wicked things, but I never left the church, everyone around me treated me like I was a good boy. And so I was stung with Pharisaical religion, and it's difficult to shake. Impossible, but praise the Lord, He has given me a view of Jesus. He has led me to fall in love with my Savior, and little by little, He's teaching me and showing me how bankrupt I am. So let us look now, what happened in that instant? Do you want to see?
Yeah.
What happens in heaven in that instant that the thief stopped being a thief and became a saint? You want it?
Yeah.
You don't sound excited, man. We have to give you an injection of South American blood. And your power. Yes. Okay, come to the book of Romans. Romans is my favorite book. Romans chapter 3. There's two words that you have to identify here to understand Romans chapter 3. And there's a lot of arguments going, you know, that have gone for centuries over Romans 3. But in reality, it's very simple if you can understand two words. One is the word righteousness. What is that word?
Righteousness.
And the other word is the word justification. What is the other word?
Justification.
Now, in the English, they are not related, but in the Greek, they are. They are closely related. The word justification in the Greek is the means, is the experience by which we obtain righteousness. In other words, justification is the vehicle by which we receive righteousness. And what is righteousness? Righteousness is character. What is righteousness?
Character.
It's a character that makes us acceptable before God. As a matter of fact, it's His character. Did you hear that? Okay, so what is righteousness? One word definition. What is righteousness?
Character.
And how do you receive that character? By justification. So what is justification? Imagine it like this. It's a youth. And the youth is driven by the Holy Spirit, and it brings it to you. And what is the youth loaded with? Character. What character? The character of God, righteousness. And that character makes you near. If you have it, that character makes you accepted before God. But how many of us have it? How many of us are righteous? Say it. Loud and clear. How many of us are righteous?
None.
Wonderful. Praise the Lord. So what do we need?
Jesus.
Yes, but what experience we need to go through?
Justification.
If we go through justification, what do we receive?
Character.
Righteousness. Is that clear? When I ask the audience, answers. This is a university hall. This is not a church. Well, it is a church. Wherever the Spirit of the Lord is, there is a church.
Amen.
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 Okay, verse 21. Well, verse 20 says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh, and we'll interpret that word justification, no flesh receives righteousness. So by the deeds of the law, we cannot receive that which recommends us to God, a holy, pure character. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. So now Paul is going to tell us how we receive righteousness. But now the righteousness of God. Which righteousness?
Of God.
Apart from the law is revealed, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. What is Paul trying to tell us there very quickly? Good. I'm running short of time. But they said that we can get together at 5:30. We're not going to go. We'll stay all the way here until 5:30.
What do you reckon?
No. How it works is this. Paul says that God has revealed his righteousness. That word reveals literally means paraded, made public. Why has God made public his character? What character is that? Well, his love, his gentleness, his kindness, his patience, his all that beautiful attributes of God, he has revealed it, but not through the law, it says. Through whom? Through Jesus Christ. Christ is the perfect parading of God's character. He has made it public, he has made it beautiful. So that when we look at Jesus, we go, wow, what a God we have. And the law and the prophets testify to that character. The law and the prophets say, it is true, it is true. God is like that.
Amen.
And, but what is the purpose? Is as we contemplate the character of God, something will happen. The Spirit will create a longing to be like Him. I want to be like Him. But also, the Spirit of the Lord will witness through the law that you are not like Him. As you see the patience of God, you will see how impatient you are. As you see His kindness, you will see how unkind you are, and so on and on and on. That's why God has paraded His character, His righteousness, in the Scriptures and in the life of Jesus. And now we all have it in the Scriptures. Do you want to have that character? Do you want to be like Jesus?
Yes.
Amen.
Do you want to have the beautiful glory of God, His lovely goodness?
Amen.
The thief had it. How long did it take for him to have it? Let us look at it. Then it says in verse 22, even the righteousness of God. Yes, Paul says, that character, the character of God, through faith in Jesus Christ. Well, that is a wrong translation. More accurate is through the faith of Jesus Christ. What is he saying us? That the character of God has been made available to us because of Christ's faith. Because of his faithfulness, because of his victory, because of his life. Now, that righteousness of God, his glorious character, becomes available to human beings. To whom? Well, it says next. Through the faith of Jesus Christ, to all and on all who? Did you notice that? He will say it clear. In other words, God gives his character, God gives his righteousness to who? Say it loud and clear, friends. To those who believe. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that what happened with the thief? And then it says, for there is no difference. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Verse 24. This is power packed. Being justified, how? How do we receive the character of God? How do we receive that character of God? It's a gift. It's free. Being justified freely, being given the character of God freely as a gift is bestowed on us. When we believe. It's an act of the grace of God. It's not because we deserve it. It is because God is so good, friends. Oh, it is because we need it. The greatest argument we can ever give God is our need. It's how much we need. Jesus, it's how much we need his character, Lord. I'm empty of any goodness, but you are good, and you have promised that you will give me your character in Christ. I come to you in all my wickedness, but I want you to give me your character. I long for your character. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. For they shall be filled. The promise of the Lord is when the longing is created in our souls to have his character, he shall give it to us if we believe. How simple, isn't it? Is it simple? Or is it difficult to receive salvation? Could you imagine? Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. I will. But you have to come down your cross. And you have to show us that you deserve it. So I'm going to work a miracle. I'm going to give you another 20 years. Okay, now you're going to be a good Christian. Is that what happened?
No.
What happened? Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. How long did it take? Does that mean that if I take hold of that promise today, being justified freely by His grace, if you believe it and I believe it, does that mean that I can walk out of this room justified, covered, filled with God's character in His eyes? He looks at me and he says, there it goes, one just like me. Is it possible?
Yeah.
Or was that only a reality for the thief? Just think of it. What a marvelous promise, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that it is in Christ Jesus. This has been made possible because of Christ's redemption. What does that mean? It's because Christ has paid the price of our freedom. He has paid the price of our death. He has made us free, dear friends. He has repurchased the human race. And now everyone who wants to be righteous can be righteous if we take Christ, because He is our righteousness. In Christ, the Father has bestowed His righteousness on us. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
That's why we cannot trust in ourselves. But that's why Christ is the answer, the solution to the problem. He who has Christ shall be satisfied. He who is thirsty will no longer thirst, but he will become a fountain of living water and give water to many others. Come to verse 28. Paul says it here in one punch. He brings the whole argument to a conclusion. Now, some of you who are at university and you write essays, what is a conclusion? It's a conclusion, isn't it, when you wrap and you bring all your arguments together? Yes?
Yes.
And you give the final punch. And then you present your essay. Well, Paul is presenting an argument, how we are justified. And now he brings it all in one, and it says there in verse 28, therefore we conclude that a man is justified. What is justification? Remember the youth? Justification is the experience by which the Lord gives us His character, His righteousness. And so Paul says that a man receives the character of God by faith apart from the works of the law. Isn't that glorious? Oh, every time I accept Christ as my Savior, every morning when I kneel before His presence and I contemplate Him crucified, I say, Lord Jesus, You are my Savior. You are my righteousness. And Paul has written, and I quote those two verses, and then I say, thank You for giving me Your righteousness. I believe with all my heart that in You I am righteous.
Amen.
Thank You. I don't have to prove Him anything. I don't have to try to be good. Because now the Lord is in charge of my life. I've got 5 minutes. Come to chapter 4, verse 5. Probably my favorite verse, chapter 4, verse 5. But to him who does not work, but believes on Him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is accounted, imputed as righteousness. Did you notice what is the condition for me to receive His righteousness? There's two conditions in that text. Did you notice that? One is that I must be ungodly. Did you notice that? That's what it says, doesn't it? Now to him who does not work, but believes on him who justifies who? The ungodly. Are you ungodly? Anyone here ungodly? I am chief of sinners. Amen? That's why, friends, it will never, in this side of human history, there will never be a time when the Spirit will give me a sense that I am good. Because if I come to the point where I think, oh, I am good enough, I will cease to receive the righteousness of God, because God needs to justify the ungodly. And the closer I come to Jesus, the more that righteousness is shown in my life, the less I will see myself as being good. There is something funny. There is in your life a sense of complete assurance, but there is never a sense that you have arrived. The opposite. The more you see Jesus, the more wicked you realize you are, and the more you crave for his righteousness. Why? Because he only justifies the ungodly. Any ungodly here? I am. And I tell you something, I'm glad that the Lord has shown me my weakness. I am grateful each time he opens my eyes and he shows me how weak, how wicked I am. I am grateful and I rejoice. Because the more I know how faulty I am, the more of Jesus I will want. Amen?
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 Amen.
Now to him who justifies, now to him who believes in him. What is the second condition? Is that in spite of your ungodliness, you believe that God will justify you because of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Just think that you are that thief on the cross. Just see yourself hanging on the side of Christ. All of us deserve to be there. Would you turn to Jesus and say, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. If you believe with all your heart that Christ is your Savior, that he paid for your sins, and that he is your righteousness, the Lord gives his character. Now, there is a word there that says is accounted or is imputed. That word speaks of two realities, and I must finish, so I'm going to speak very briefly. Justification is the giving of the character, but the word imputed, accounted, speaks how God actually gives that character. And that is a proclamation that God does. God speaks his word. Paul says, or Peter says, that we are born through the word of God. And it is at that moment when you, by faith, take hold of the righteousness of Jesus, when you give him your life and you accept him as your Savior, and you believe that in Christ God accepts you, and he forgives you, and he loves you, and he treats you, that you have never sinned. This is what happens in heaven, and this is what happened the day the thief on the cross was forgiven. The Father in heaven says, did you see that ex-thief? Did you see that say he was called Stephen? Did you see Stephen? He has just said that my son is the king. That's faith. Because he has believed in my son, I forgive him of all his sins. As a matter of fact, he has never sinned. I love him as I love my own son. He is my eye. That is justification by faith. And there is an argument in theological circles whether justification justification is simply a declaration of God and it doesn't have, it has anything to do with you, or does justification make a difference in your life? And let me say to you, if God has declared it, it is impossible for God, for what God has declared, not to become what he has declared. So the moment that God declares me righteous, The Spirit of the Lord comes and dwells in me, bringing that righteousness. And in that very second, sanctification begins, and I am transformed from inside out. And as time goes by, the fruits of my life will testify that Jesus dwells in me. That is what happened to the thief. I wonder how many of you today would like to say to the Lord, Lord, remember me. Lord, I am sinful, but today I take Christ as my Savior. And I believe that because of Him, you give me His righteousness. Is there anyone here who would like to say that to the Lord, believing it with all your heart, that God will give you His righteousness now? If that is your desire, would you stand where you are and we may pray? Wonderful. We have a wonderful Savior. Amen. Let us pray. Father, our Daddy, you couldn't make it any easier for us to be accepted. And yet, so difficult, because it goes right against our grain. But your Spirit has spoken to our heart. He has subdued the flesh this afternoon, this evening. And we stand before you to confess with our lips that Jesus is our Savior. And that we accept Him as such today. Dear Father, we believe that He is our righteousness, that He is our everything, and that in Him you are forgiving us all our sins, you are giving us your righteousness, and you are declaring us that we are your children and that you love us as you love Jesus in this very moment, and that we, like the thief on the cross, have been turned from guilty to saved. Father, we believe it. And therefore, we thank you. Oh Lord, there are no words to express our gratitude. We love you, Lord. Now we pray that that righteousness that you have implanted in our soul through your Spirit in this very moment will give fruit to your glory. That, Father, our life will testify that we belong to you, not because we are forcing ourselves to do it, but because Jesus is living in us. Oh Lord, we praise you and give you glory. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Happy Sabbath, everyone.
Happy Sabbath.
I'm very happy to praise the Lord today. I apologize in advance because I'm going to sing in Spanish. My English is not too good enough to sing in English, but we know that the message of God is the same in every language.
No.
asombroso.
Spiritual food you've given us. And now, dear Lord, we also want to thank you for the physical food that has been prepared. Dear Lord, it comes from the same source. It's Jesus. And it is his sacrifice, Lord, that tells us the cost at which this food has been purchased. We thank you for it. Bless it, please. May it strengthen us and provide a beautiful environment for fellowship. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.